the situation in Ukraine becoming more and more desperate. Russia's missiles are leaving a trail of devastating destruction in their wake. The latest attacks happened overnight. Chief correspondent Chris Reason gained extraordinary access to one of the key bombing sites in Kyiv just hours after it was hit, a college that only days ago was buzzing with students.
Well, the first thing that strikes you about this missile attack is the sheer power and scope of the impact and how much of the building it has devastated. Almost nothing is left inside. It's just the exterior structure, but even that is gone. This building is going to have to be demolished. But we know exactly where the missile hit. Take a look at this. It's carved a crater much taller than me down here. The impact then has just smashed the exact center of the building and ripped out this central structure, collapsing it, and every single room in the wings either side has been devastated. They did not miss. Now down here, a couple of pieces of the shell casing. Our security expert has told us that is straight from the missile itself. So you look at something like this and you think, why would the Russians have targeted this building? What strategic value? Was it some sort of military facility? We can answer that with this, a textbook. Fingers, nails. It's a cosmetics college, a TAFE, in which the kids, 17 to 21 year olds, were studying cosmetics, food tech, barista work, bar work. It's Ukraine's version of TAFE. One missile struck at midnight last night. We could hear it from our accommodation just a couple of kilometres over that way. You come round here, alarm's still going. Inside, no room's been left untouched, as you can plainly see there. Look at this, blackboards, classrooms. This is a kids' college. What the one piece of good news we have about it is that it closed down as soon as the war began last Thursday, and so there were no students here anyway, but there are fears that inside there was a security guard. They found a pool of blood. The question is why? The question is why the Russians would have wanted to target this. We honestly don't know. A question the locals can't answer.
Russian President Vladimir Putin has upped the stakes over his invasion, ordering his nuclear forces to go on high alert. Chief correspondent Chris Reason reports from Kyiv.
Well, the Russian president says this is all because of the West. He says there were two reasons he was forced to make this move. He says he has no choice because, first of all, to use his words, of the threats that have been coming from NATO, and also because of the devastating effects of those economic sanctions on the Russian economy. Is he about to press the button and launch a nuclear war? Well, experts say no, he's not. But this raises the tensions in Ukraine and this part of the world to unprecedented levels. An oil terminal burns in Kyiv, but after days of bitter fighting, Russian troops have been unable to seize key objectives. This is the remains of a Russian convoy that entered the Ukrainian capital. The tenacity of the Ukrainian forces and resilience of its people clearly frustrating the Russian president. Summoning top generals, Vladimir Putin ordered them to put nuclear forces on high alert.
NATO countries are making aggressive statements with regards to our country. Therefore, I order you to transfer the deterrent forces of the Russian army to a special mode of combat duty.
Despite Putin's unprecedented threats, at the same moment, Russian negotiators were waiting in neighbouring Belarus to begin peace talks. Ukraine's foreign minister agreeing to meet the delegation on the Ukraine-Belarus border.
And if the outcome of these talks will be peace and the end of war, that should be welcomed. But we will not, again, and I want to make it very clear, we will not surrender.
Ukrainian forces still control the capital and claim to have repelled Russian troops from the country's second largest city, Kharkiv, where there's been street-to-street fighting with Russian special forces. Earlier in the day, Russian patrols appeared to be making headway into the suburbs, but it didn't last long.
Ukrainian civilians playing their part, ambushing them with petrol bombs. This, an abandoned Russian convoy being picked over by Ukrainian troops as reinforcements arrive from the south to bolster the defence. But the Russian artillery continues to fire on Ukrainian positions, and missiles continue to explode on the streets of Kyiv.
We know exactly where the missile hit. Take a look at this. It's carved a crater, much taller than me, down here. The impact then has just smashed the exact center of the building and ripped out this central structure, collapsing it, and every single room in the wings either side has been devastated. They did not miss.
Ukraine's largest cities battered but unbroken. Now, Russia has the world's largest nuclear arsenal, some 4,500 nuclear warheads. Is he going to use them? As we say, no. But it's potentially going to give him, he thinks, the upper hand and to be able to negotiate a face-saving deal.
And for reaction on both of today's top stories, I'm joined by political reporter Rob Scott live for us in Canberra. Rob, let's start with Ukraine. Scott Morrison's warning Australians keen to join the fight against Russia not to travel to the region.
Yeah, that's right, Ange. There's actually, as we speak, a growing foreign legion of international volunteers assembling in Ukraine, ready and willing to take up arms and fight against the advancing Russian troops. And while he understands why it might be appealing to some Australians, Scott Morrison is strongly advising against it. It's actually illegal for Australian citizens and visa holders to join conflicts overseas unless they're serving in the official armed forces of a foreign country.
Australians who travel to fight in Ukraine with a non-government armed group on either side of the conflict or who recruit someone else to do so may be committing a criminal offence.
I can understand absolutely the strong feelings and the motivations for people to go and do that. I would counsel against that it's purely for the safety of Australians that they would not travel to Ukraine.
Directly at Vladimir Putin came into force at midnight. The government says it's incredibly rare to target a head of state, with the Russian president joining a small but notorious group, including Zimbabwe's Robert Mugabe, Muammar Gaddafi of Libya, and Syria's Bashar al-Assad.
Let's move on to the floods now. What help is the federal government offering to people affected?
Well, Ange, residents in more than 12 local government areas can now access one-off disaster relief payments of $1,000 per adult and $400 per child to help cover basic needs. 200 Defence Force personnel and helicopters have also been dispatched to help with rescues in Lismore.
The crisis has not yet passed. Those floodwaters will remain at their peaks for some days yet.
So both the floods and the crisis in Ukraine will be top of the agenda when the National Security Committee of Cabinet meets tomorrow.